Do good work is not a label, but a way of living. It is the constant and diligent effort to achieve a new level of excellence in one's own life. It is the hidden inner beauty behind the struggle to achieve excellence. It's not perfect, but imperfect. It is the effort, discipline, and focus that often goes unnoticed. The goal of Do Good Work is to highlight that drive. The guests I have on this show emulate this drive in their own special way. You'll be able to apply new ideas into your own life by learning from them. We will also have one-on-one episodes with me, where we'll dive into my own experience with entrepreneurship and leadership. Every episode is designed to provide you with ideas that you can apply and grow in excellence in all areas of your life, business, and career.
Today on the show, we have Patrick Dichter. He works with Cultivate Advisors, which help mid-sized businesses grow faster and work smarter on their business. Cultivate is a 2X Inc. 5000 List member for their fast growth and amazing results in their clients. And the last company that Patrick has worked and helped grow, it was a startup, a digital marketing firm, from 0 to $35 million in 7 years, hiring and helping sales teams grow all over the country. Currently lives in Denver, loves to fly fish actually, and is a self-proclaimed business geek. So we're in good company here. Patrick, thanks for being on.
Thanks for having me on, Raul. Appreciate it.
Awesome, man. Well, I'm really excited to dive into more about the story and that 7-year experience where you focused on sales and helping companies grow in that regard. And I know right now with some of the things that are going on, some companies who are growing and some companies that want to either create more sales teams or expand their sales with the current in the new economy, what are some of the translating habits that work well with you that we can adapt into our businesses today?
All right. Sounds good. Hopefully we can unpack that. It is strange times right now, you know, this new normal, but I do think anyone that's playing offense and trying to solve sales right now, I think it's a land grab. So you can grab market share, you can pick up clients, you can grow a lot faster than somebody else who is a deer in headlights right now. So we can dig in on a lot of those things. But I think if you are, you know, hiring a salesperson, building out a sales team, trying to drive up your outbound, working on your inbound, I think you're in a great spot, because I think you're going to find talent at a discount, you're going to find opportunities, and you're going to be able to grow and pick up market share that might have been a lot more competitive before.
And I love that. We're looking at it from not just an abundance mindset, but also talent is on a discount. We're able to expand more. And I really want to dive into the sales habits it wasn't overnight, clearly. So success never is overnight. So it was over the 7 years, but yeah. What were some of those sales habits that you deployed and that you helped your team grow in as you grew that firm?
Yeah, I'll give you a long answer. Prior to that is where a lot of the habits came from. So during my undergrad and MBA, I sold door to door in college. Mm-hmm. And this company, Southwestern, is so good at taking a college student who knows nothing about sales and turning them into just a sales monster for 10 or 12 weeks in the summertime, right? Wow. So there's 2,000 to 3,000 college students that still do this every summer, and you're selling straight commission door to door 80 hours a week. And you know, an average first year student makes $9,000 or $10,000 in the summer. And they're able to get that sort of production because there's just a really good blueprint in a system for buying into the habits and getting the skills up. So I did that for 4 years during school, and I helped lead and build teams during that time. And then I moved from Denver to Columbus, Ohio with that startup. And I didn't know anything about digital marketing. I didn't know B2B sales. And I just went and figured it out. Some of the habits that we picked up, we were able to really distill it down and boil it down into daily habits. So we got to the point where we, you know, really had this mantra that everyone strives and lived up to, and it was 10-3-2. So every single day, the goal was to get a hold of 10 new decision makers, whether that was in person, via email, or via phone, set 3 new appointments, and then run 2 demos. Mm-hmm. And if you could aim for that your first 6 months and get close to that or hit that, you were going to have success and you're really going to do well. But what it did is it just allowed reps to put the blinders on, and it gave us really a baseline to be able to train everyone else on. So that's one thing that I always try to do with clients now, is establish really a weekly cadence or a daily cadence for, you know, reach out, contacts, and proposals out the door. Because if you can start there, the rest usually falls into place.
And I want to dive into that because I love, one, it's tangible, two, and I think another habit that you kind of glossed over was you figured it out, right? I think that habit is the tendency of, you know, high achievers. But one of the things specifically that I want to go dive into is the 10-3-2. So the 10 is getting new decision makers, and I want to distinguish what a lead is and versus what a lead isn't. So can you identify what is that 10 mean? Is it just, I have a new email address that I reached out to, or I sent a new phone call and they said yes, or maybe how do you identify what that, who falls under that 10 category? Because it's not just, oh, I just found a new email online.
Right. So for us, we're measuring that 10 when a new conversation got started. So if you were in their business, we're selling, you know, to mom and pop businesses. So if you went into the law firm, or you went in the landscaping office, whatever, and you met the owner and got that new conversation started, that would be a contact. Or if they replied to your email, that would be a contact. Or if you got a hold of them on the phone, that would be a contact.
Perfect.
So that's what we were really starting with. And then from there, as you get these stats, you can start to see effectiveness. So if somebody has a lot of contacts and they're not translating into appointments, you just coach them on what they're saying or their objection handling, right? Mm-hmm. But if somebody's not getting enough conversations started, it really doesn't matter how good their pitch is, because the numbers game doesn't work out. So then you're coaching them around their time management or around their willingness to do the reach out. That's the way we measured it. For other clients, I think you can call it a lead once maybe they get to the first call, or, you know, once you have a new marketing qualified lead. There's a lot of different ways to slice it, but it is important just to have that clear definition on what is a
conversation. And then from there, how do you set those appointments? And I think, you know, breaking it down to those tangibles, because there's obviously on top of that, we can dive a little bit into it, either outbound or inbound marketing to get those conversations going. And one of the things that was kind of interesting, you know, getting this podcast set up with you, is that you mentioned that inbound is overrated. And that stuck with me for weeks, for days until we had that, like, why is inbound overrated?
Yeah, shots fired at HubSpot. HubSpot is a good company. It's a good tool. But they sell this dream of, like, you're going to inbound market your way to 50 million in revenue. And that's just not the case. And, you know, they have their own outbound sales team. The reason I say inbound is overrated is because it's a long game, and I'm not sure enough people really invest the proper resources and then enough time to see that pan out. Mm-hmm. And then even if you get the inbound lead flow going, you don't have a tight sales process, it really doesn't matter. So
it leaks.
Yeah, at Cultivate, what we see is people scale from 0 to 10 million. There's these classical stages. And one of the biggest stumbling blocks they have is trying to create a sales engine that's not reliant on the owner.
Yeah.
So the owner up to that point is thinking, it's my reputation, it's word of mouth, which is true. It's inbound, which is true. But if you never get off of that, you'll never be able to scale. And so what you're going to do is either burn out as an owner or cap your growth. Or if you go hire a sales rep and you don't do it properly, a lot of times they'll fail in the first time they try to hire a sales rep. Mm-hmm. It's a really big investment. So that's why I say inbound is overrated. There's other reasons as well. I think a lot of people are trying it. I also think sometimes the leads that come to you with inbound, you don't have much control and influence over. And if they're not ideal, you can't do anything about that. So I think if you can mix outbound as like what you start with, and then you have the content to back that up, I just think it's faster, it's easier to manage, it's easier to test. So that's why I say inbound is overrated. And, you know, we can all thank HubSpot for selling that Kool-Aid when really they're selling you a CRM system. But
yeah, no, and I appreciate that frame of mind, because you need both, right? You can't just rely on saying I'm going to get leads coming inbound specifically, but I think it's having that long-term approach. And I even see this as well. Like, I've helped and managed with clients on their paid advertising strategies, right? And it's not just going to be one campaign that's going to make it work. Typically, what I've seen from historic, it's anywhere between 3 to 5 to 15,000 in ad spend, even up to 20,000 to actually get something to work. And that takes time, and that takes money, and that takes commitment. And I think those three things, like what you mentioned earlier, is that if you're not going to have the proper resources or the proper frame of mind of understanding this is a long-term game, then you're just going to quit. But I also do think that not having anything on the inbound side will leave you weak as you kind of transition what I believe into the, not the owner of, or the CEO selling all the time for the company. So can we talk a little bit about what are some of the classical phases that you see from companies growing, let's say, to, you know, high six figures or six figures and reaching their millions, and then from there, 3, 5, 8, 10 million and beyond.
Yeah. So in your book, actually, you talk about inflection points are these stress tests that can either be really positive or really negative, and some of the habits. And as we see people go through those first two stages, the first two, the habits that get you there are doing everything yourself and willing it and your personal reputation and being a control freak about things mm-hmm. to have a really good product. And to get through the next stages, you almost have to do the inverse. You have to let go and you have to delegate and you have to trust people and you have to look at KPIs instead of micromanaging every single project. So I would say that's a big one that we see a lot, is people having to adapt and let go if they're going to scale mm-hmm. as they get through the other stages. Obviously the sales engine is a big one where, you know, you're trying to get outside the owner. I think the other thing is just proactive versus reactive. Up through those first couple of stages, you're just firefighting like day to day, week to week, whatever comes in your inbox. And as you get through those other stages, you start to plan a week out, and then you plan a month out, and then you have quarterly rocks. And then you're like, holy crap, we have a game plan for next year, you know? And you start to really look at the data and say, what was our plan versus what actually happened? Mm-hmm. And just being more intentional with what you want to see happen in the business versus just reacting to what your clients and what your marketplace brings to you. So I think those are some of the big recurring themes that we see no matter the industry.
When it comes to, obviously there's different habits and different action items that need to happen to reach from phase one to phase two and two and three. Are there commonalities and themes between each phase though?
Mm-hmm. Yes, for sure. It's definitely, there's themes around owner's time and productivity and mm-hmm. where that should be. There's themes around the type of people that you hire. In the first couple of stages, you want to hire more generalists, people that can help wear a lot of different hats with you. As you get through the other phases, you want to lean more on specialists. There's also, you know, different roles the owner should take as a visionary later in the company. It's more leading, managing people versus in the day-to-day.
Yeah.
And the way you approach recruiting has to change too. It's almost like your most important task in the last couple of stages is around just recruiting really good talent.
That's what I've been saying. Yeah, that's what I've been hearing as well. Like for startups that are growing really fast, it's almost I'm focusing either on recruiting or just training all day. And These are like managers of tech teams in fast growing startups, and they have like 40 people under the wing with a manager. It's like, it's crazy, right? That's how like the evolution of the growth curve goes.
Yeah. Those are the biggest themes that we see in those phases.
In those areas. So when it comes to owners and applying in their phase, how do they self-identify which phase they're in right now? And from the self-identification, what are some action items each owner can do from each phase? So how do I identify if I'm in phase one?
Yeah, I think we have general guidelines on our website, but it usually starts with the number of team members. And
so team size.
Yeah. So, you know, like the second phase we call experimenter, where you're maybe tweaking with the product a little bit. If your headcount is under 5, that's probably a good indicator that you're at, you know, that phase. And then from there, we'll look towards headcount, and then we'll look towards if your, you know, products and offerings are really defined. And then depending on the industry, we're probably then going to look at where is the owner's time being spent, like if they're still billable in the heavy day-to-day of the business, or if they're more like up in a kind of senior or C-suite and you've got a middle layer of management.
Okay. And then so it's headcount, my involvement in the company, and then to move from phase to phase, it's letting go, it's being able to administer a team. And you also mentioned on tweaking the product, like, can you talk a little bit more about that? Is the just the evolution of the product or service itself, or is it more just expanding into different product lines and expanding the brand suite?
Yeah, we call the second one the experimenter, because you might say like, you know, up to that point, I was just a general web design agency. And then you decide to really layer claim that, you know, we just do, you know, Shopify and Google AdWords for people. And that's the lane that we're going to stay in. And these other custom things we're not going to touch anymore. Or you might say, you know, we're a construction remodeling company, and we decided to niche down on commercial retrofits, and that's really our lane. So up to that point, you might just be taking whatever projects come in to help, you know, keep the lights on and keep your team busy. And that's where we say, like, from experimenter to the next phases, it tends to be more profitable because you really narrow down on
the focus and then focus make sure that you have the wage or the expense ratio go lower as revenue increases.
Got it. Yeah.
That's awesome, man. Yeah. Well, for our listeners, what's the best place to reach out to you or to connect with you, or thank you for the show?
Yeah. Appreciate you having me on. So if they want to go to my site, it's patrickdichter.com, D-I-C-H-T-E-R. You can also check us out at Cultivate Advisors and then, you know, reach out to us there on LinkedIn or check out some of the social links there.
And I'll include all that in the show notes as well.
Yeah. We appreciate the opportunity and we love the work that you're doing and loved getting a chance to dig in on your book as well. So awesome. Thanks for having me on.
Patrick, thanks for being on, man.
All right. See ya.